इवनिंग सर।
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, हाउ आर यू? ओके, सो वी हैव वन न्यू स्टूडेंट, हालिमा। ऑल राइट, just a minute. All right, so Halima and Mazin, have you studied something in economics?
Yes.
All right, this is going to be your first economics class, right?
No sir, I had one before.
You have attended one class, the previous
yes.
one.
Yes.
All right, this will be the first class for Halima, right?
Yes.
Yes, Halima.
Sir, I was saying that I was having economics and business. Sorry, accounting and business, not economics.
Accounting, not economics class. All right. So basically, we are having economics class right now. You can drop this session, and you please join us at around 10 o'clock. We will be doing accounts class.
You mean 7:30?
Yeah, 7:30 as per your time.
Okay.
So basically, okay, we will discuss the economics part in for 1 year, one hour, and after that we will start the accounting. So you can.
Okay, sir. I'll come session. After an hour.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Bye.
And what about business?
We will let you know about business. Nishkash will get to you, and he will basically inform you about that. Don't worry about that.
Okay, I'll wait for the text.
Allah okay, Hafiz. Okay. Samiksha, Steve, and Mazin. So basically, we were studying consumers' equilibrium in the previous class, and we have discussed basically what we were doing, what topic we were covering in the last class. Can anyone of you remind me?
Marginal utility and total utility.
Marginal utility, total utility. All right. See, in this chapter, we have already covered the meaning of consumer. Consumer is basically a person who consumes good or any kind of service. And then we have also understood the meaning of equilibrium. Equilibrium is, in economics, equilibrium is basically a situation of maximum satisfaction. And consumer's equilibrium is basically a situation where a consumer is spending his income in such a way that he gets maximum amount of satisfaction from consumption of goods and services. All right. Then I have also explained that basically there are two approaches to understand the entire concept of equilibrium. And both of these concepts were given by two different economists. One was Professor Alfred Marshall, and the other one was basically J.R. Hicks and his associate Allen. So the theory which was given by Alfred Marshall in order to prove or in order to basically support the theory of support the consumer equilibrium theory is basically known as utility approach. And consumer equilibrium, as per J.R. Hicks and Allen, has been explained according to indifference curve approach. So basically there are two approaches to understand the entire concept. Now we are only covering the utility approach. And according to utility approach, we must understand at least five topics in order to understand the entire concept of consumer equilibrium. So I think we have already understood the meaning of utility, right? I have told you that utility is basically a satisfying power of a commodity. The amount of satisfaction a person derives from consumption of a commodity is basically called utility. And one thing that basically Alfred Marshall states that utility has a special characteristic that it can be measured in terms of number. It can be expressed in terms of cardinal numbers, and we can also measure it in terms of utils. All right. After that, I have also taught you that utility is basically subjective in nature. That is, it varies from person to person, time to time, and place to place. After that, we have discussed the concept of total utility. Then we have covered the marginal utility. And I think we were discussing in the previous class the concept of law of diminishing marginal utility. While discussing law of diminishing marginal utility, I have told you that law of diminishing marginal utility is basically law related to consumption. This law basically states that when a consumer consumes more units of a commodity, the amount of satisfaction that consumer achieves or drive keeps on declining with every successive unit, with every extra unit that consumer consumes. So basically, if a consumer keep on consuming a particular commodity, let's say if a consumer is basically consuming apples, so with every additional unit of apple, the amount of satisfaction that he will be getting will keep on declining, or there will be a situation when the amount of satisfaction will be zero. He will not be getting any kind of satisfaction. And even after that, if he continues to consume more units of the commodity, he will in fact receive negative amount of satisfaction. That is what I have already basically explained about law of diminishing marginality. We have also taken an example to understand the concept of law of diminishing marginal utility, where I have basically said that if a customer, let's say he's thirsty and he drink one first glass of water, so he basically get 20 utils of satisfaction. All right. Now with every glass of water he consumes, the amount of satisfaction that he will drive will keep on decreasing. All right. Okay. And after that, we have, I think, also understood the various assumptions of law of diminishing marginal utility. How many assumptions have I taught you?
Four
assumptions. So for those four assumptions were basically that we can express the utility in terms of cardinal numbers. We can express the utility in number. Then we have also assumed that that customer consumes the commodity in reasonable quantity or in standard size. All right. And after that, I have also taught you that there must be continuous consumption of the commodity. If consumer keep on consuming the commodity continuously, then only amount of satisfaction will keep on declining. If there is so much time gap between the consumption of two units, one after the other, and if there is unusual time gap, then law of diminishing marginal utility might not be applicable. After that, I have also said that there must be no change in commodity or quality of the commodity. Quality and commodity must be same. If a consumer is drinking water, he must be offered same quality of water, same glass of water every time, then only amount of satisfaction will decrease. If instead of giving water we start giving him juice, then the amount of satisfaction might not decrease. Eventually there is a possibility that his satisfaction starts increasing. And there is one more assumption that we also assume that there is no change in income and prices of the commodity of the consumer. See, what happens if there is change in the income of the consumer, then there is a possibility he starts getting higher amount of satisfaction. Suppose income of the consumer declined, so when his income was high, the amount of satisfaction that he will be getting from the commodity might be less. But all of a sudden, when his income decreases, he starts liking that product, which he does not used to like when he used to be rich, when he used to have a higher amount of income. So utility is very much affected by the income as well. So what do we do while understanding the entire concept of law of diminishing marginal utility? We presume that there is no change in income of the commodity. All right. And similarly, we also assume that there is no change in price of the commodity. Commodity price is also remains constant. So all of these things we have covered in the previous class. In today's class, we will be discussing about how we can basically represent the law of diminishing marginal utility in a diagrammatic presentation. And one more thing that I'll be discussing in today's class is what is the relationship between total utility and marginal utility. And one more thing that we will be discussing, see what had happened earlier, that I have skipped a few topics from the introduction part of microeconomics. So we will be covering those topics as well in today's session. All right. So those topics that I have skipped in the first chapter, we will be covering those topics. So give me a minute. Let me start on the notebook. Okay. See, law of diminishing margin. How can we express the law of diminishing marginal utility in tabular form? Number one, we will be expressing law of diminishing marginal utility in the tabular form, tabular representation of law of diminishing marginal utility. See, how can we represent law of diminishing marginal utility in tabular form? First, we will make the column of units. Then we will take the marginal utility column. Sorry. Then total utility column. All right. Now what do? We take the units of commodity. Like suppose consumer is consuming 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and let's say suppose he's consuming 7 units of a particular commodity, and the additional satisfaction he is getting, suppose he gets marginal utility of, let's say, 20 utils when he consumes the first unit, he gets 15 utils of extra satisfaction, then he gets 10, then he gets 5, then he gets, let's say, 0 or 2, then he gets 0, and then he gets minus 5. So every time he is consuming the commodity, the amount of marginal utility he is getting is basically decreasing. That you can basically see in this table. Now what happens when we need to calculate the total utility? In the last session, I think I have also explained, I have also taught you how can we calculate the value of total utility. How do we calculate total utility at the first unit? So you have told us that at the first unit, marginal utility and total utility will always be equal. All right. And after that, at the second unit, because marginal utility is 15, so we will add this value to the total utility. So total utility will become 35. And after that, we will add 10 more. It will be 45. Then it will be 50. Then it will be 52. Then 0 added to 52 will be 52. And after that, we will reduce the total utility by 5 utils. So it will be how many units?
47.
All right. So this is how we represent the law of diminishing marginal utility in a tabular form. Now, what do we have to do? We are now required to present the law of diminishing marginal utility diagrammatically. So we will make a diagram, diagrammatic representation of the LDMU, law of diminishing marginal utility. So in order to express this in the diagrammatic form, we take two axes. This is the, we have y-axis, and this will be our x-axis. All right, x-axis and the y-axis. All right. Now in the last class, I have already taught you that because marginal utility goes on declining, so you can start making the diagrammatic expression, diagrammatic representation of marginal utility from any point on the diagram. And all you have to consider is that marginal utility basically goes on declining from the point of starting. So suppose if the marginal utility is starting from this point, all you need to do is make a downward sloping curve. This is a marginal utility curve, and it indicate that utility of the commodities goes on declining. All right. Now we are needed to represent the total utility on the diagram. So what I have basically taught you in the last class, that total utility initially increases. See, 20, 35, 45, 50 and 52. Till this point, till the fifth unit of the commodity, total utility is increasing. Till the fifth unit of the commodity, total utility is increasing. So what do? We initially make an upward sloping total utility curve. We make a diagram, we make a total utility curve that will goes upward. But after the fifth unit, total utility will become constant. So we are also required to indicate the constant value of the total utility on the diagram as well. Now what happens at the seventh unit? At the seventh unit, total utility starts to decline. So basically, when we make the total utility diagram, we have to ensure that it indicates three characteristics of the total utility. That it must increase initially, it become constant, and then it should decline. And always remember that total utility will be constant just at the point where marginal utility is zero. When marginal utility is zero, then only total utility will be constant, 52 and 52. So how can we present it on the diagram? See, we will make the total utility curve starting from the same point where marginal utility was starting. So we will start it something like this. It will go on increasing in a concave form. It will make a concave shape curve. After that, it will become constant. All right. And now it will start to decrease. This is total utility. Make sure that the point where marginal utility is zero, at the same point, total utility must be constant. It should be constant at the same point. See, here marginal utility is zero. And this is where total utility is constant as well. All right, everyone. Is this clear to everyone? So yes, this is marginal utility. This is total utility. So what this point is basically indicating, this is indicating that at this point, marginal utility is zero. And at this point, what is total utility? Total utility is constant as well as at its maximum value. Total utility is maximum at this point as well as constant at this point. See, in the table as well, the point at which marginal utility is zero, total utility is constant, right? And at the same time, it is also at its maximum value. 52 is the maximum value of total utility. So always keep this in mind. The point at which marginal utility is zero, total utility will be constant and at its maximum. And what happened in this area before the marginal utility is zero, what is happening in this area? So in this area, marginal utility is basically decreasing. It is continuously decreasing, but it is positive. It is decreasing, but it is positive. All right. Only after it goes to zero and after that it becomes negative. But before zero, it is decreasing and it is in the positive terms. See, in the table as well, before it is zero, marginal utility is continuously declining, 20, 15, 10, 5, and 2. But all of these values are in positive terms. All right. And see, when the marginal utility is decreasing, what is happening to the total utility? So total utility is continuously increasing. All right. And what happened when marginal utility becomes negative? What happens when marginal utility becomes negative? Sir, when marginal utility is negative, total utility starts to, what is happening here? Total utility starts to decrease. It is decreasing. Is it clear to everyone? See, in the table as well, when marginal utility is decreasing, but it is not zero, till the point it is not zero. The point till the marginal utility is decreasing, but it is not zero, total utilities keep on increasing, 20, 35, 45, 50, and 52. This is decreasing, but it is increasing. As soon as the marginal utility becomes zero, total utility becomes constant. All right. And reaches its maximum point as well. And after this, when marginal utility becomes negative, total utility starts to decline. Is it clear, everybody?
Yes.
So on the basis of this, we can basically write the relationship. You have to write this. I have not included this in the PowerPoint. You have to note this down. You have to basically note this down. You will write. In fact, you have to note everything. The table that I have drawn here, the diagram that I have made, and the relationship I'm going to write here, you have to draw everything. So let me do complete this. You just wait and understand everything. Only then you start writing. I'll give you an extra time for that. All right. See, first of all, what are we going to do? We are basically we want to state the relationship between total utility and marginal utility. We have to basically identify what is the relationship between total utility and marginal utility. So what is the relationship? How can we write it? We can write it, number one, when marginal utility decreases, total utility increases, right? When marginal utility decreases, when marginal utility is decreasing, total utility increases. Is it correct or incorrect? Is it correct or incorrect? When marginal utility decreases, total utility increases.
Yes.
And you can basically relate this point on the diagram as well as on the table. We are able to see that marginal utility is decreasing, but before the point it becomes zero, total marginal utility is decreasing and total utility is basically increasing. And you can also see this on the table. Marginal utility is decreasing 20, 15, 10, 5, and 2, but total utility is increasing 20, 35, 45, 50, and 52 till the fifth unit. I'm talking only till the fifth unit. So we can write it as, when marginal utility decreases but remains positive, then what happened? Then total utility increases. All right. And after that, now you will tell me, when marginal utility is zero, what happens to the total utility? When marginal utility is zero, then what happens to total utility?
It remains constant.
Correct. Constant, and it becomes constant and maximum. All right. See, here marginal utility is zero and total utility is constant as well as at its maximum. And at the same time, we can also relate this on the table. When marginal utility is zero, total utility is constant as well as at its maximum. Now, third relationship will be, when marginal utility is negative, what happens to the total utility? Total utility starts, when marginal utility is negative, total utility starts
decreasing. What happened? Decreasing.
Very decreasing. Good. Very nice. Decreasing. This is it. So all of these things, you have to write it on your notebook. So shall I wait or you will take the screenshot?
Sir, I wrote.
Sir, can you show the third one?
Just a minute. Let me zoom out a little. I'm not able to zoom out. I don't know what happened.
Sir, will take screenshot. I will take screenshot.
So noted one.
Sir,
by
I
one.
Noted.
You have noted it?
Yes, sir.
And what about others?
Sir, I finished before.
You finished. All right. So do I have to wait or everybody is done?
Done, sir.
Done. All right.
Thanks,
okay.
Sir.
You can continue.
All right. So this is it. This is basically law of diminishing marginal utility. We have covered everything with respect to law of diminishing marginal utility. First of all, we have covered the definition part, that wherein I have explained that law of diminishing marginal utility is basically a law that states, it is basically a law related to consumption, which states that whenever a consumer consumes more unit of a particular commodity on a continuous basis, the amount of satisfaction that he'll be getting is basically keep on declining. All right. And considering the definition, we have made a table based on the definition, and we have also presented diagrammatically we have presented the definition, and we have also covered the relationship between total utility and marginal utility. So all of these topics are done. So basically, we have completed the law of diminishing marginal utility part. Now, after this, in consumer equilibrium, the topic that we are basically discussing, we are actually required to cover a few more topics after that. That is just a minute. Usually after law of diminishing marginal utility, I start teaching students what is the meaning of consumer's equilibrium according to Alfred Marshall. But now for the time being, we are skipping this topic and we will now first complete those topics that we have skipped in the first chapter. Because what happened, some of you have joined between the chapters. So I had to start a new chapter, and due to which I have left few topics in the previous chapter. So what do we do now? We will first complete those topics. Only then we will come back to this chapter. All right, everyone?
Okay, sir.
Okay. So what we will be discussing now, just a minute. Okay, this is the basic part that this is basically introduction part of economics, the first chapter. All right, so see, in the first chapter I think I have told you what is the meaning of economics. Economics is basically a subject matter. It is basically a subject that basically guides us or teaches us to allocate the resources in a manner so that we can have the maximum benefit out of it. All right, so economics is basically a subject matter which basically guides us to allocate the resources in a manner that it can provide maximum amount of benefit to everyone. Now the topics that need to be covered are these. See, there are two branches of economics. I have not covered these topics. All right. See, there are two branches of economics. On the basis of branches, we can categorize the economics as microeconomics and macroeconomics. Micro and macroeconomics. Do you guys have any idea what is micro and macroeconomics? Anyone? Sameeksha, Steve, or Peer Muhammad, Mazin?
So microeconomics is like economics which they take in like small amount, and macro is a big amount. Macroeconomics is basically like for like a small area. Macro is like for the whole country.
Very good. Nice. Anyone else? Sameeksha, you want to try? Do you have any idea what is micro and macro?
No idea.
All right. See, in economics, what happens? We sometimes discuss these things at the unitary level. And whenever the things are discussed at unitary level, it is covered in the microeconomics branch of economics. And whenever we discuss anything at the aggregate level, we discuss anything in holistic manner, we covered every aspect of anything is basically called macroeconomics. So basically there are two branches of economics. One is micro and macro. What does micro do? Micro analyze the economic development at the unitary level, and macro is basically dealing anything on the macro level. Let's take an example to understand this concept. Suppose let's talk about automobile industry. All right, so can you name few automobile companies? Automobile industry, we are talking about automobile industry. So can you name any automobile company? Say for example, Audi is one of the automobile company. Then there is Mercedes. So do you guys have any idea other than these companies? Audi, Mercedes,
Rolls Royce.
Okay, Volkswagen. All right, Volkswagen, sorry. And other than this?
Toyota.
So these are the companies in the automobile. I'm sure there are so many other companies. But now, right now, let's presume that there are only five companies in the automobile industry. And what I wanted to know the sales or basically turnover of these company. I wanted to know the profits and losses of the company. I wanted to know the number of employees working in these companies, all right, and the total number of cars they produce in the period of 1 year. So I basically wanted to know their production capacity. All of these things, I basically wanted to know about these companies, about all of these companies. I want to know the sales turnover, profit, losses, employees, production capacity of not only one company. I want to know the information, all of these information about the entire automobile industry. I want to collect the information, all of these information regarding Toyota, Volkswagen, Rolls-Royce, Mercedes, Audi, every company. So this is called, I am basically discussing the entire automobile industry. I am discussing about the automobile industry at the aggregate level. Getting my point? I am discussing the entire automobile industry at the aggregate level. But what happened if I am only interested in knowing the position of the Audi, if I am interested in knowing the sales and turnover of the Audi, if I am interested in knowing the profit and loss of the Audi, number of employees they are working for the Audi, and their production capacity. If I only talk about the Audi, then it will be treated as what kind of economics? It will be treated as microeconomics, because I am discussing at the unitary level. Among all of these, I am only talking about Audi. So this is called that I am making basically a unitary discussion. So this is basically called microeconomic concept. And when I start collecting information, or if I'm interested in knowing all of these things with respect to all of these company of basically regarding entire industry, then it is basically called the macroeconomic concept. So this is the basic difference of micro and macro. Microeconomic discusses the individual things, unitary things at unitary level, and macroeconomic discusses everything at the aggregate level. Let's suppose I just wanted to know the income of this person. I just wanted to know the income of Mr. X. I just wanted to know the production cost of X company. Suppose there is an X company who is producing a particular product. I just wanted to know what is the cost of production for that company. I just wanted to know the income of the consumer. I just wanted to know the demand for a particular product in the market. Getting my point? I just wanted to know the income of one consumer. I wanted to know the production cost of one company. I wanted to know the demand of a particular product, one product. So while discussing all of these things, the thing which is common in all of these is that I am discussing everything at the unitary level only. All right, but what happens when I start discussing the national income? If I wanted to know what is the income of the country, what is the total income of our economy, what is the rate of employment, what is the employment status of the country, what is the rate of inflation or deflation of the country? Getting my point? So basically, we are discussing at the aggregate level. So whenever we discuss at the aggregate level, this is called macroeconomic concept. And whenever we discuss the things at the unitary level, this is called microeconomic concept. Is everything clear to all of you, Samiksha and the other guys?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay, moving on. Yes, sir. Let's go to the slide and let's try to understand their explanations. See, in microeconomics is basically a branch of economics that basically deals with the behavior of individual unit of an economy. All right. And for example, what kind of things we include in microeconomics? We include demand of consumer, of a consumer. All right. Cost of a firm, individual income, all of these things are basically covered in microeconomics. Whereas macroeconomics is also a branch of economics. But this studies the behavior of aggregate. It discusses everything at the aggregate level. It is not concerned with the unit of a particular thing. if it is basically suppose we are discussing about the telecom industry, then we will discuss every company operating in the telecom industry. If we are discussing about automobile industry, and then while discussing the macroeconomic concept, we will cover every company covered in the basically working in the automobile industry. These are few examples of macroeconomics: national income, aggregate demand of economy, and the balance of payment of the country, inflation, deflation, employment. All of these things are macroeconomic concept. Okay. All right. So we are done with the micro and macro part. See, there is one more classification of economics. We have right now we were basically categorizing the economics on the basis of branches, right? So if I ask you what are the various branches of economics, you can say that sir, there are two branches of economics, that is micro and macroeconomics. But we can also categorize the economics on the basis of approach of study. Listen to me carefully. On the basis of approach of study, how do we study anything? So on the basis of approach of study, we can categorize the economics as positive and normative economics. Positive and normative economics. On the basis of, see, whenever we discuss anything, whenever we study anything, whenever suppose we are talking on any economic development, suppose I am talking about employment, inflation, income of the country, national income, or about any other thing. All right. So I can have two approaches of a study. First one is the positive approach and the normative approach. What is positive approach? That is what is basically positive economics. See, whenever you study or analyze anything and you just collect information, you describe such fact and basically quantify the information. Getting my point? You are basically doing research about something. And after the research, you are basically describing the fact and the information you have collected, or basically you are quantifying everything that you have collected, that you have gathered through during your research. So this is basically called positive economics. While presenting any information, if you are not adding your any opinion or value judgment to your research, then it will be considered as the positive economics or positive statement. Keep on listening. I will basically explain both these economics through example, but listen to me very carefully now. So basically, positive economics, what do we do in positive economics? We basically say, for example, we research about anything, and after the research of about anything, we are basically describing the situation, what it is actually. We are describing, we are quantifying, and we are basically informing the other person what is the actual situation. Suppose I say that there is increasing unemployment in the country. According to the research I have conducted, the unemployment in the country is continuously increasing. So this is the statement. Please tell me, when I say that there is increasing unemployment in the country, am I making or am I giving any opinion of mine? Is there any value judgment from my side? Or am I just expressing the fact or information in front of you?
Just a fact.
It is just a fact. This fact can be correct or incorrect. That is a matter of verification. You can verify this fact through Google or through some other basically search engine or anything. What I am basically saying, I am just expressing, I'm basically describing or quantifying any information in front of you. I'm not adding my opinion. I'm not adding my value judgment. Suppose I say that GDP of the country is continuously decreasing. So this is basically a fact-based information. You can cross-check it. You can verify it. But what happens when I say that unemployment is continuously decreasing and government should introduce employment generation program in order to tackle these situations. If government introduces program, then I'm sure that rate of unemployment will decrease. So now this statement involves my opinion. First of all, I have mentioned that there is increasing unemployment in the country. This is fact. Now I am adding my opinion. I am saying that if government launches some employment generation program, then government can tackle the situation of unemployment. Now this is my opinion. All right. So there is a difference. In the first statement, I have just basically presented the fact and information in front of you. In the second statement, I have expressed my basically fact and information along with my opinion and value judgment. Is it clear to everyone? So basically, I can make two kind of statement. If I am making a plain statement, having no value judgment, having no opinion of mine, it will be considered as a positive statement. That is known as positive economics. On the other hand, if I state any fact of information, and along with the fact or information, I basically also add my value judgment or opinion to that, it will become normative statement or normative economics. Everybody, please tell me, is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let me give you an example, and you have to identify whether it is a positive or a normative statement. All right. Let's say during the period of COVID-19, production of automobile industry have declined, or the sales of automobile industry have declined to the drastic level. So can you identify what kind of statement it is, positive or normative statement?
Positive.
Anyone else? Peer, what about you? What is this statement? Is it a positive or a normative statement?
Positive.
Positive statement. Because I am just expressing, I'm just basically informing about the fact. Now, I'm not saying this fact must be correct. This can be verified. It is the matter of basically a verification. You can verify the fact whether sir have provided the correct information or incorrect information. That is a different thing. Point is that I'm not making any kind of opinion or value judgment to that. Now I am making one other statement. I say that suppose during the COVID-19 period, automobile industry's sale have declined, and companies if company makes advertisement and promote they basically advertise through news channel television or newspaper, they will be able to increase their sales. This is my statement. Identify whether it is a positive or a normative statement.
Sir, can you repeat, sir?
Okay. I said that suppose I am saying that automobile industry during the COVID-19 period, automobile industry sales have declined, and in order to increase their sales, these companies should promote their sales through advertisement in the newspaper or television or something like that. Please tell me, is it a positive statement or a normative statement?
Sir, normative
statement. Why it is a normative statement? Because I am adding my opinion to it. Initially, what I was doing, I was just making statement. Now I am also adding that in order to increase the sales, what company should do. So it will now become the normative statement. Is it clear to everyone? So if we can precisely say that, positive economics basically deals with what is, what was, what will be. What is the situation? What was the situation? What will be the situation? This is it. But normative economics deals with what should be, what ought to be, what has to be done in order to correct the situation. Getting my point? So whenever you add opinion or value judgment to any statement, it will become a normative economics. Okay, let's move. Let's understood the positive and normative through the definition. Positive economics is a stream of economics that has an objective approach, relied on facts. All right. Now it concentrates the description, quantification, and clarification on economic development, prospects, and allied matter on the basis of relevant fact and figures. All right. So basically, positive economics, what does positive economics do? It basically describes, quantify, and clarify about any economic development or any fact or figure. any information. After that, we can also say that in simple terms, positive economics basically deals with what actually is, and it can be further tested and verified. This is very important. Positive economics can be subject to test, can be verified. All right. But moving on to the normative economic is basically a strong stream of economics where that has an subjective approach and based on theoretical situation. All right. Like, it focuses on the ideological perspective based opinion oriented statements. And in simple terms, normative economics basically deals with what ought to be, what should be. And one important thing is that it cannot be verified. It cannot be tested. How can you test the opinion of a person? A person making opinion, you cannot test the opinion. Can you test the opinion? Suppose if I say that company promote their sales through advertisement, company will be able to increase their sales. This is my opinion, no? Can you verify the opinion? Can you Google that whether I am basically giving the right or wrong opinion? No, you cannot verify it. Opinions cannot be verified. Is it clear to everyone? Samiksha, Peer, Steve.
Yes, sir.
And Mazin.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Anyone, any doubt? All right. I think everything is clear until now. So we have covered basically two topics. First of all, I have classify the economics on the basis of branches, that is micro and macro. And after that, we have categorized the economics on the basis of approach of a study. So there can be two approaches of a study, normative approach or positive approach. In the positive approach, what does economists do? Economists basically collect information and basically describe the fact that he have collected. But if an economist is having normative approach, so what he will do, he will basically collect information about something, about any economic development, and after that he will also give his opinion in order to improve or whatever, basically in context of such a situation he will give the opinion regarding that. All right, next, one more thing that we need to cover is that types of economy. This is the last point that we'll be doing. After this chapter is finished, and we will continue our second chapter that we were doing, law of diminishing marginal utility and consumers equilibrium. So what is the various types of economy? See, there are three types of economy. Number one is capitalist economy, then there is socialist economy and mixed economy. This is very easy. See, what is a capitalist economy? Capitalist economy is basically a structure of economy where most of the control and resources are owned by the private sector. Listen to me carefully. In every economy, there are primarily two sectors operating in the economy, private sector and the government sector. Private sector basically means private owners, like private investors, and public sector basically means government. So government is also known as public sector. So basically in every economy, there are two sectors, private sector and public sector. Now, in every economy, the approach of private sector is more of a profit-oriented approach. Every private entity aims at maximizing the profit of the firm, profit of the business, right? But what is the approach of government? Government have the welfare approach. Government work for the welfare of the public, all right? So always remember that private entity operate with the objective of profit maximization, and public sector or government basically operates with the objective of public welfare. All right. Now moving on to our first type of economy, that is capitalist economy. What is a capitalist economy? Capitalist economy is a type of economy where most of the resources are owned and controlled by the private sector. Getting my point? All of the resources, or most of the resources, are under the control of which sector? Private sector. That is, private sector will decide what to do, how to do, and whom to do. Remember, I have basically I have explained there are three central problems in every economy. Do you guys remember that? There are three central problems of every economy. What to produce, how to produce, sir. And who to produce. So basically, if the economy is a capitalist economy where control and ownership of every resource is under the hand of the private sector. So in the capitalist economy, private sector will be deciding what to do, how to do, and for whom to do. What goods and services we should produce, by what technology we should produce, and for which section of society we have to produce goods. Everything is decided by the capitalist economy. And capitalist economy decide everything on the basis of profits. Capitalist economy produces such goods which have maximum profit. Capitalist economy chooses that technique of production which has minimum cost. Capitalist economy chooses the section of society for whom goods should be produced on the basis of their paying capacity so as to maximize their profits. Getting my point? So basically, capitalist economy is an economy where most of the resources are owned and controlled by the private sector. That is, major economic decisions, that is central problem of the economy, are basically solved by the private sector. Private sector will only decide that what to produce, how to produce, and for whom to produce. And because it is a capitalist economy, the approach and orientation of doing anything is profit. They will work with the target, with the aim of maximizing the profits. Now, what is a socialist economy? Socialist economy is completely inverse of the capitalist economy. In the socialist economy, all of the resources are primarily owned by the basically owns the resources in the socialist economy. Can you guess? Can anyone guess? Socialist economy, who owns these resources in the socialist economy? See, there are only two sectors, private and government sector.
Government.
So in the socialist economy, right? In the socialist economy, all of the resources are primarily owned by the government. So who will be deciding what to produce, how to produce, and for whom to produce?
Government.
And can you tell me what will be the approach of government in doing or deciding any or resolving any problem? Profit-oriented approach or public welfare approach?
Public welfare approach.
Very good. And because all of the resources are owned by the government, and all of the central problems are resolved by the government. So basically, in the socialist economy, public welfare are basically focused. Public welfare are basically given the most importance. All right. Now, what is a mixed economy? Can anyone of you guess what is a mixed economy? What kind of economic structure it is?
Mixture of private and
both private.
Correct. So, like if I talk about India, where I live, so mixed economy, what happens in the mixed economy? Mixed economy is basically under the control of both government as well as private. Under the mixed economy, see, most of the economies are mixed economic structure. America, Japan, and you have, let's say, Saudi, Dubai. Most of the countries have the mixed economy structure. So what happens in the mixed economy? All of the resources are shared between private and government. Some resources are owned and controlled by the private sector. Some resources are owned by the government sector. So in the mixed economy, what happens? They collectively decide and resolve the central problems of economy. They collectively resolve the central problems. Say, they collectively decide what to produce, how to produce, and for whom to produce. Like if I talk about India, when you observe India, you will be able to see that in every sector, both are operating, as well as private, as well as government. See, if I talk about healthcare sector in India, you will see that government is also participating in healthcare system in India, as well as private sector is also involved in the healthcare. You will see private hospital as well as government hospital. So basically, in the health sector, we will see government as well as private sector. Similarly, if you closely see the education sector structure of India, education sector of India, you will be able to see that here also we have private school as well as government schools. All right. If you see the transport system in India, you will be able to see that there are basically transport are also carried out by the government as well as by the private sector. So in India or in any mixed economy, because all of the resources are shared between private and government sector, so you will see the participation of both the sector in such economy. And you will see that in such economy, central problems are also collectively resolved. Private sector, basically in the mixed economy, private sector operates with the objective of profit maximization. And at the same time, government also operating in such an economy with the objective of public welfare. So both the sector goes hand in hand. Both the sector contribute in the development of economy collectively. Is it clear to everyone? Guys, please tell me, Samiksha, B, Steve. All right. See, so I think we have covered a lot of topic in today's session. We have covered law of diminishing marginal utility, its tabular representation, diagrammatic representation. We have also covered the relationship between total utility and marginal utility. I have also explained various types of economics. I have basically categorized the economics on the basis of branches as well as on the basis of approach of a study. So we have categorized it as microeconomics and macroeconomics. We have further classified it as basically positive and normative economic. Then we have also categorized the type of economy. We have also studied about type of economy that are basically there are three types of economy worldwide. Number one is capitalist, then socialist and mixed economy. What is a capitalist economy? Where resources are owned and controlled by the private sector. Socialist is basically resources are owned and controlled by the government sector. And in the mixed economy, resources are owned and controlled by both the sector collectively, and they collectively resolve the problem of the economy. Socialist economy work with the objective of public welfare. Capitalist economy works with the objective of profit maximization. And mixed economy basically works with the objective of both profit as well as public welfare. Private sector aims at profit maximization, and public sector aims at the public welfare. So this is it in the economic section. All right, I think everything is clear to all of you, right? So yes. We will be this is it for economics. We will be starting the accounting part, accountancy section in let's take a break of 5 minutes, and we will be starting accounts, and in that we will be discussing accounting equations. All right, so take a break of 5 minutes. I'll be joining you in 5 minutes. All right, stay connected, but don't leave the session.